ಸ್ವಧರ್ಮ ಜ್ಞಾನ ವೈರಾಗ್ಯ ಸಾಧ್ಯ ಭಕ್ತೇಕ ಗೋಚರ ನಾರಾಯಣ ಪರಂಬ್ರಹ್ಮ ಗೀತಾಶಾಸ್ತ್ರೇ ಸಮೀರಿತ. ದಿಸ್ ಇಸ್ ಅ ಸಂಗ್ರಹ ಶ್ಲೋಕ ಆಫ್ ಸ್ವಾಮಿ ಯಾಮುನಾಚಾರ್ಯ ಇನ್ ಇಸ್ ಗೀತಾರ್ಥ ಸಂಗ್ರಹ. ದ ಅಲ್ಮೈಟಿ ಶ್ರೀಮನ್ ನಾರಾಯಣ ಇಸ್ ವೆಲ್ ಎಕ್ಸ್ಪ್ಲೈನ್ಡ್ ಇನ್ ದ ಭಗವದ್ಗೀತಾ. ನಾರಾಯಣ ಗೀತಾಶಾಸ್ತ್ರೇ ಸಮೀರಿತ. ಅಂಡ್ ಹೌ ಡು ಐ ರೀಚ್ ನಾರಾಯಣ? ಧರ್ಮ ವಿಚ್ ಇಸ್ ಭಕ್ತಿ, ಭಕ್ತೇಕ ಗೋಚರ ನಾರಾಯಣ ಗೀತಾಶಾಸ್ತ್ರೇ ಸಮೀರಿತ. ಭಕ್ತಿ ಇಸ್ ದ ಓನ್ಲಿ ಮೀನ್ಸ್ ಟು ರೀಚ್ ನಾರಾಯಣ. ಭಕ್ತೇಕ ಗೋಚರ ನಾರಾಯಣ. ಹೌ ಡು ಐ ಗೆಟ್ ಟು ದ ಸ್ಟೇಜ್ ಆಫ್ ಪ್ರಾಕ್ಟಿಸಿಂಗ್ ಭಕ್ತಿ? ಸ್ವಧರ್ಮ ಜ್ಞಾನ ವೈರಾಗ್ಯ ಸಾಧ್ಯ ಭಕ್ತೇಕ ಗೋಚರ. ಸ್ವಧರ್ಮ, ಒನ್ಸ್ ಓನ್ ಪ್ರಿಸ್ಕ್ರೈಬ್ ಡ್ಯೂಟೀಸ್ ವಿಚ್ ಇಸ್ ಪ್ರಾಕ್ಟಿಸಿಂಗ್ ಕರ್ಮಯೋಗ. ಜ್ಞಾನ ಅಲಾಂಗ್ ವಿತ್ ದ ಬೇಸಿಕ್ ನಾಲೆಡ್ಜ್ ಅಬೌಟ್ ದ ಜೀವಾತ್ಮ ವಿಚ್ ಇಸ್ ದ ಜ್ಞಾನ ಪಾರ್ಟ್ ಆಫ್ ಇಟ್. ವೈರಾಗ್ಯ ಡಿಟ್ಯಾಚ್ಮೆಂಟ್, ಕರ್ತೃತ್ವ ಬುದ್ಧಿ ತ್ಯಾಗ, ಮಮತಾ ತ್ಯಾಗ, ಫಲತ್ಯಾಗ. ಸೊ ಸ್ವಧರ್ಮ ಜ್ಞಾನ ವೈರಾಗ್ಯ ಸಾಧ್ಯ ಭಕ್ತೇಕ ಗೋಚರ ನಾರಾಯಣ ಗೀತಾಶಾಸ್ತ್ರೇ ಸಮೀರಿತ. ದಿಸ್ ಇಸ್ ದಿ ಎಸೆನ್ಸ್ ಆಫ್ ಗೀತಾ. ಸೊ ನೌ ವಿ ರಿಯಲಿ ಗೆಟ್ ಇನ್ ಟು ದ ಕೋರ್ ಕಾನ್ಸೆಪ್ಟ್ ಆಫ್ ಗೀತಾ ವಿಚ್ ಇಸ್ ಭಕ್ತಿಯೋಗ. ಸ್ಟಾರ್ಟಿಂಗ್ ಫ್ರಮ್ ದ 7th ಚಾಪ್ಟರ್ ಟು 9th ಚಾಪ್ಟರ್ ಕೃಷ್ಣ ಡಿಸ್ಕಸ್ಡ್ ಅಬೌಟ್ ಭಕ್ತಿಯೋಗ, ಎಕ್ಸ್ಪ್ಲೈನ್ ದ ವೇರಿಯಸ್ ಥಿಯರೀಸ್, ದ ಡಾಕ್ಟ್ರಿನ್ಸ್ ಇನ್ ಭಕ್ತಿಯೋಗ. ಅಂಡ್ ಇನ್ 10th ಅಂಡ್ 11th ಚಾಪ್ಟರ್ ಕೃಷ್ಣ ಮೇಕ್ಸ್ ಅರ್ಜುನ ಬಿಲೀವ್ ದಟ್ ಒನ್ ಹ್ಯಾಸ್ ಟು ಪ್ರಾಕ್ಟಿಸ್ ಭಕ್ತಿಯೋಗ, ಒನ್ ಹ್ಯಾಸ್ ಟು ಬಿಲೀವ್ ದ ಡಿವೈನ್ ಆಟ್ರಿಬ್ಯೂಟ್ಸ್ ಆಫ್ ಶ್ರೀಮನ್ ನಾರಾಯಣ, ವಾಟ್ ಎವರ್ ಇಸ್ ರಿಕ್ವೈರ್ಡ್ ಫಾರ್ ದಟ್ ಟು ಸಬ್ಸ್ಟಾನ್ಶಿಯೇಟ್ ಇಸ್ ಭಕ್ತಿಯೋಗ. ಕೃಷ್ಣ ಡಸ್ ದ ಸೇಮ್ ಇನ್ 10th ಅಂಡ್ 11th ಚಾಪ್ಟರ್. ಅಂಡ್ ಅಗೇನ್ ಇನ್ 12th ಚಾಪ್ಟರ್ ಹಿ ಎಕ್ಸ್ಪ್ಲೈನ್ಸ್ ಸಮ್ ಕ್ಯಾರೆಕ್ಟರಿಸ್ಟಿಕ್ಸ್ ಆಫ್ ಅ ಭಕ್ತ. ದಸ್ ದ 7th ಟು 12th ಚಾಪ್ಟರ್ ಇಟ್ ಡಿಸ್ಕಸಸ್ ಅಬೌಟ್ ಭಕ್ತಿ ಯೋಗ. ಇನ್ ದಟ್ ವಿ ಆರ್ ನೌ ಎಟ್ ದ ಬಿಗಿನಿಂಗ್ ಆಫ್ 7th ಚಾಪ್ಟರ್. ನೌ ದೇರ್ ಆರ್ ಸಮ್ ವರ್ಡ್ಸ್ ವಿಚ್ ವಿ ಹ್ಯಾವ್ ಬೀನ್ ಡಿಬೇಟಿಂಗ್ ಇನ್ ದ ಪಾಸ್ಟ್ 4 ಡೇಸ್. ಒನ್ ವರ್ಡ್ ಇಸ್ ಜ್ಞಾನ, ವಿಚ್ ಇಸ್ ನಾಲೆಜ್. ನಾಲೆಜ್ ಯು ಹ್ಯಾವ್ ಅನದರ್ ವರ್ಡ್ ವಿಚ್ ಇಸ್ ದಿಸ್ ಉಪಾಸನ, ಸೇ ಎ ಫಾರ್ಮ್ ಆಫ್ ಮೆಡಿಟೇಷನ್. ನೌ ವಿ ಆರ್ ಇಂಟ್ರೊಡ್ಯೂಸ್ಡ್ ಅನದರ್ ವರ್ಡ್ ಭಕ್ತಿ. ಲೆಟ್ಸ್ ಬಿ ಕ್ಲಿಯರ್ ಅಬೌಟ್ ದ ಡಿಫರೆನ್ಸಸ್ ಬಿಟ್ವೀನ್ ಜ್ಞಾನ, ಉಪಾಸನ, ಭಕ್ತಿ, ನಾಲೆಜ್, ಮೆಡಿಟೇಷನ್ ಅಂಡ್ ಡಿವೋಷನ್. ದ ಸಿಂಪಲ್ ವರ್ಡ್ ಇಸ್ ನಾಲೆಜ್ ಅಂಡ್ ಅ ಹೈಯರ್ ಪ್ಲಾಟ್ಫಾರ್ಮ್ ಇಸ್ ಮೆಡಿಟೇಷನ್ ಅಂಡ್ ಅ ಸ್ಟಿಲ್ ಹೈಯರ್ ಪ್ಲಾಟ್ಫಾರ್ಮ್ ಇಸ್ ಡಿವೋಷನ್. ನೌ ವಿಚ್ ಇಸ್ ಗೋಯಿಂಗ್ ಟು ಲೀಡ್ ಮೀ ಟು ಮೋಕ್ಷ? We have already discussed here, the first 6 chapters talk about Atma Sakshatkara, realizing my Jivatma. The second 6 talks about realizing my master, who is Paramatma. And the means to realize oneself is Karma Yoga and Jnana Yoga, first 6 chapters. The means to realize Paramatma is Bhakti Yoga, the second 6 chapters. The first question would be, why should I agree that one should realize Paramatma? 2. And why should I agree that Bhakti Yoga is to be practiced to realize Paramatma? Why not the same Karma Yoga and Jnana Yoga? Let's first answer these 2 questions. To answer them, you need the help, the source of various Vedic statements, Vedanta Vakyas, to substantiate your view. First, let us see, what does Vedanta say that this is the way to reach Paramatma? Before that, do I agree to a Paramatma at all? Why should I? I am able to agree that there is a soul inside me. At least that much is possible. But I am not able to see Paramatma anywhere. I am not able to see the Jivatma. But at least by my usage, somehow I am able to feel that there is someone directing who is inside. It's not this body alone. It's not this flesh and bone alone which is the total. Whereas there is someone inside which is Jivatma. By some argument, hook or crook, you can prove that. And anyone in this world will agree to that. But the problem will arise when we want to prove about the Paramatma, because no one has cited him. Even all the atheists, they don't deny the existence of a Jivatma. They will only deny the existence of Paramatma. For any atheist, problem is never with the Jivatma. He agrees he is there, because without him, who can be an atheist? At least I have to agree to him. So Jivatma is agreed by one and all. And there is one more who is agreed even by an atheist, an Acharya. So, an Acharya is so important, he is more important than the Paramatma. One who denies the existence of Bhagavan, an atheist, will never deny an Acharya. Because to teach him atheism, you need an Acharya. Acharya is inevitable in any, be it a theist or an atheist, an Acharya is required. So, Acharya is important, agreed by atheists too. Jivatma is agreed by them. Whereas, come to the case of Paramatma, why should I agree the very existence of a third power? I have the objects of pleasure. I am here to enjoy that pleasure. Why should I agree on the third? There is no requirement. But we are pushed to agree to the same, because there is someone who is directing that this object should be enjoyed by this soul in such and such time at such and such place. It's not that I can totally decide on my own. Now, I sit on my dining table. My food is served. I just start to eat. The doorbell rings. I have to go to attend to the call. I open the door. Actually, that person was not for my house. He came, he took a wrong address and came to me. I have to explain to him, it's not my house. It's four houses later. He went. I again sat. The telephone bell rang. I have to attend. It was a wrong call. I kept it down. Then after 5 minutes, I started eating this. Now, who decided that at 8 PM I cannot have it? It should be had only at 8:10. There is no one there. I was very much available, willing to take the food with full of hunger. Food was available. I am not going to earn it anymore, not later. So when both were there, who pushes or decides? You can name it as your karma. You can name it as your sattvam, rajas, tamas. Some third force. Let's not name it as God. I am not telling you to accept it is God. Let it be something. So agree on some third force which acts on you, which decides that this is the time and this is the place when I enjoy my own objects of pleasure. This food was not earned by someone else. It was earned by me only. It was not served by someone else. It was served by my wife only. It was not on a plate of my next door. It is on my plate only. When everything is mine, whereas that 8 to 8:10 does not belong to me. So there has to be a third force which decides this mine should enjoy this only at a particular point of time. So some call the third force as karma, some might call it as sattva rajoguna, some might call it as nature, some may call it as coincidence, Vedantins call it as God. So this is the only difference now. But anyhow, you will have to agree on a third force. Let's not dwell that the third force has to be God. That's not our topic of discussion today. So you will have to agree on third. And as per Vedanta, that third force is known to be Ishvara, the controller of Chit, the object, and Achit, the Bhokta, person who enjoys it. So Bhokta, Bhogyam, Prerita. You have the Achit, which is the object, the enjoyed. One who enjoys is the soul. One who directs to enjoy is the Ishvara. So these three are known as Tattvatraya. Now, how does this soul reach God? Before that, once we agree on this Paramatma, why should it be Bhakti Yoga? What is the way mentioned in Vedanta to reach Paramatma? For Atma Sakshatkara, Purushuktam, this is the simplest of all. Let's just take from there, because many people would be knowing it by heart in this hall. Purushuktam says, Tamevam Vidwan Amrita Iha Bhavati Nanya Panthaha Ayanaya Vidyate Tamevam Vidwan, Tamevam, that Brahman. Vidwan, one who knows that Brahman, one who realizes that Brahman. Vidwan, Vedanam is Jnanam. Vidwan, one who has knowledge. Tamevam Vidwan, Amrita Iha Bhavati, reaches him. Amrita Iha Bhavati, Amritam, no more death, no more old age, no more thirst, no more hunger. Amrita Iha Bhavati, తమేవం విద్వాన్ అమృత ఇహ భవతి న అన్యః పంథాః. వేదాంత ది కేటగారికలీ సే దట్ ఐ డోంట్ ప్రిస్క్రైబ్ ఎనీ అదర్ వే దాన్ దిస్. న అన్యః పంథాః, పంథ ఇస్ వే, న అన్యః పంథాః, దర్ ఇస్ నో అదర్ వే దాన్ దిస్ జ్ఞాన. సో జ్ఞాన నాలెడ్జ్ ఈస్ ద ఓన్లీ వే టు రీచ్ పరమాత్మ. జస్ట్ నోట్ డౌన్ దిస్ కోర్స్ ఫ్రమ్ దిస్ కోట్ ఫ్రమ్ పురుష సూక్త, తమేవం విద్వాన్ అమృతైః భవతి నాన్యః పంథాః అయనాయ విద్యతే. అండ్ లెట్స్ డిఫైన్ దట్ నాలెడ్జ్ నౌ. నౌ వెన్ ఇట్ సెడ్ నో యువర్ బ్రహ్మం, ఇస్ ఇట్ దట్ ఐ షుడ్ నో హీఈస్ ఇన్ శ్రీరంగం? ఇస్ ఇట్ ఎనఫ్ వెన్ ఐ నో హీఈస్ ఇన్ సే లివర్మూర్ టెంపుల్? ఇస్ ఇట్ ఎనఫ్ దట్ ఐ నో హీఈస్ ఇన్ న్యూయార్క్ రంగనాథ టెంపుల్? ఇస్ ఇట్ ఎనఫ్ దట్ ఐ నో బాలాజీ స్టాండ్స్ ఇన్ తిరువేంకడం ఇన్ తిరుమల తిరుపతి? బికాస్ ఐ నో దట్ నో. వేదాంత సెడ్ నాలెడ్జ్ అబౌట్ బ్రహ్మం లీడ్స్ యూ టు మోక్షం. దిస్ అ సింపుల్ స్టేట్మెంట్. నౌ ఐ నో దట్ బాలాజీ ఈజ్ బ్రహ్మం, హీ స్టాండ్స్ ఇన్ తిరుపతి. ఈజ్ దట్ ఎనఫ్ టు రీచ్ మోక్షం నౌ? బికాస్ ఐఎమ్ ఆల్సో విద్వాన్. తమేవం విద్వాన్ అమృత ఇహ భవతి నాన్యః పంథాః అయనాయ విద్యతే. కెన్ ఐ రీచ్? విల్ ఐ గెట్ రిలీజ్డ్? నో. ద వేదాంత స్టార్టెడ్ యాడింగ్ సమ్ ఫ్రిల్స్ టు ఇట్ నౌ. ఎనీ డే యూ విల్ బి టోల్డ్ వెన్ ఎవర్ దెర్ ఇస్ సమ్వన్ హూ కాల్స్ ఆన్ యూ. ఐ హవ్ సీన్ మెనీ ప్లేసెస్ హియర్ వెన్ ఐ ఎంటర్ నో సొలిసిటింగ్ నో సొలిసిటేషన్. ఐ సా దిస్ బోర్డ్, ఐ డెంట్ నో వాట్ దట్ మెంట్. సో ఐ ఆస్క్ ద ఫ్రెండ్ హూ వాస్ గైడింగ్ మీ. హి సెడ్ నో మార్కెటర్స్ ఆర్ సేల్స్ పీపుల్ షుడ్ కమ్ నియర్ యూ, దే ఆర్ నాట్ అలౌడ్ ఇన్ సైడ్ దిస్ సబ్ డివిజన్ ఆర్ డివిజన్. సో వన్స్ అ మార్కెటింగ్ పర్సన్ కమ్స్ టు యూ, హీ సేస్ యూ బై దిస్, ఇట్ కాస్ట్ యూ ఓన్లీ $10, ఐ విల్ గో అండ్ బై దట్ అండ్ ఇట్ మైట్ బి అ వాక్మెన్. దెన్ హీ సేస్ ఐ హావ్ నాట్ టోల్డ్ యూ అబౌట్ ద ఇయర్ ఫోన్ టు ఇట్, దట్ మైట్ కాస్ట్ యూ అనదర్ $3, ఐ పే దట్ మోర్. Then he said, there is no battery inside that. Would you like to have a battery? One is then it will work. And those batteries cost you $2. So these all gets added now. First thing I thought it is only $10. Then I got an earphone for $3. I got batteries for $2. Veda is also a perfect marketer. First it starts telling that, Kamevam Vidwan Amrita Iha Bhavati. You know him, you reach him. Then I told, I know him. That Balaji stands in Tirumala Tirupati. Do I reach him? No, that's not that simple. Let me tell you some more. And Vedas add now, it is not simple jnana, knowing him. You will have to meditate towards him. It slowly graduates us from knowledge to meditation, from jnana to upasana. I have to meditate. And how does that meditate? I have to meditation means taila dharavat avichinna smriti sampana rupam. This is the exact definition of upasana, meditation. Dhyanam, dhyanam everywhere. You go to yoga classes. You go to meditation classes. Let's ask first, define meditation. Define dhyana. Any day, kindly define a word. Don't keep on explaining it subjectively. You must first be able to prove it objectively to an extent. It can't be proved 100%. But still, I must be able to define a word. Define bhakti. Define karma, define jnana. You must know all those things. Unless you define something, you will be beating around the bush. So let's first define dhyana. What is meditation? Ramanuja defines it. Meditation would mean taila dharavat avichinna smriti santana rupam. Taila dharavat avichinna smriti santanam. It's a continuous thought process. I keep on thinking about it. How do I think? Avichinna. It should never be broken. It should never be hindered. There must be no obstacles to it. And he gives an example to it. Taila dharavat. Like a stream of oil flowing from an open tap. You open a tap. You take two vessels. Fill up water in one. Open the tap. See the flow of water. Fill up oil in another vessel. Open the tap. See the flow of oil. Both won't be equal. The flow of water will, it might flow this, it might flow that way. You will find lot of variations in the flow of water. Whereas when oil flows, you will find a straight stream flowing. So, once I start meditating towards my Atman, there must be an unhindered connection. Like, take the case of your internet. Now, why you get into all these things? When you dial into your internet, you get your connection. At times, data doesn't move. At times, the line gets cut. So, without all these things, if you have a continuous say all your DSL technology, whatever you use now. So if it's a DSL technology where there is no hindrance, there is no obstacle, I am directly connected like a stream of oil, taila dharavat avichinna, no obstacle, unhindered, avichinna smriti santanam, smaranam is more and more thinking about him, recollecting about him, remembering about him. So it's a perpetual, continuous remembrance of your Paramatma, smriti santana rupam. This is the definition of meditation. So now, Vedas are going to graduate us to meditation. It first mentioned, knowledge will lead you to Paramatma Sakshatkaram. Then it said, it is not just knowledge, you will have to continuously meditate towards him. So, upasana will lead you to Paramatma. It said, Atmainava, Atmanameva, Lokam, Upasita. This is an important vakya from Upanishad. Atmanameva, Lokam, Upasita. Now it says, you know, earlier I told you that it's only jnana which fetches you moksha. Now, refine that jnana. That jnana is upasana. So this is the further condition added by Veda. I'll give you an example. Suppose I say, Rama came inside, entered this hall. Rama entered. He spoke. These are the two sentences I have said now. Immediately someone got up and asked, you never said who spoke? Yes, I didn't say. I just said he spoke. But before that, I have made a statement, Rama entered this hall, he spoke. What should I immediately understand? I should understand Rama spoke. When there is a specific usage and a general usage, this general usage must be related to the specific usage only. It's rural not? Do we use like that or not? So if Rama came and he spoke, that he would certainly stand for Rama only. Now like here, similarly, the Vedas say, I told you about jnanam. Now, Atmanam eva lokam upasita. Now when I say about upasana, that would mean the earlier used word jnana would come and rest in this upasana. This has to be matured, graduated to upasana. And what's upasanam? Keep on meditating about him. Does they talk? Yes, Brihadaranya Upanishad says, Atmavare drashtavyaha, shrotavyaha, mantavyaha, nididhyasitavyaha. Atmavare shrotavyaha, first hear about him, then mantavyaha, debate within yourself about him, it's a reflection within yourself, mantavyaha, nididhyasitavyaha, unhindered meditation about him, nididhyasitavyaha, what do you do finally? Drashtavyaha, you can have his sakshatkara, you can cite him. So atmavare drashtavyo shrotavyo mantavyaha, nididhyasitavyaha. It's graduated to upasanam now. What's the difference between knowledge and upasanam? Knowledge is just simple knowledge. Upasanam is continuous, perpetual, unhindered, without any obstacle, like a flow stream of oil is upasanam. Fine. Even that I do. Is that enough? I am able to control my senses. I keep on meditating about my Lord. But unfortunately, I have no devotion towards him. I have no attraction towards him. I don't know about his qualities. I am not absorbed towards him. I never agree that he is my master. I don't agree on all these things. But somehow I am able to control my senses and able to meditate towards him. He never moves out of my sight. I am able to see Lord Sriman Narayana just in front of my eyes, even when I close. But I don't agree that he is my master. I am not a devotee of Narayana. But still I am able to meditate about him. Is that meditation, will it lead to Paramatma Sakshatkara? Will it lead to moksha? Now, Vedas had the difficulty of adding more conditions once again. It said, it is not simple meditation which will lead you to Atma Paramatma Sakshatkara. Let me add something more. It said, Nayam Atma Pravachanena Labhyaha Na Medhaya Na Bahuna Shrutena Yame Vesha Vrunute Tena Labhyaha Tasteisha Atma Vivrunute Tanum Swam. It now totally negates all the earlier statements. It says, Na Ayam Atma Pravachanena Labhyaha. This Atma, just by meditating without any devotion towards him, without any love towards his Krishna, his Lord, if he is going to talk about him, dance about him, sing on him, he does anything, ఆత్మావారే నాయమాత్మా ప్రవచనేన లభ్య బై టాకింగ్ అబౌట్ హిమ్ నా మేధయా నాట్ బై మెడిటేటింగ్ అబౌట్ హిమ్ నా బహునాశ్రుతేన యు హియర్ భగవద్గీత 10 times ఇట్స్ నాట్ గోయింగ్ టు హెల్ప్ యూ నా బహునాశ్రుతేన దెన్ వాట్ వుడ్ హెల్ప్ యూ యమేవ ఏష వృణుతే తేన లభ్య వన్ హూ హీ సెలెక్ట్స్ హీ చూసెస్ ఇస్ ద బ్లెస్సెడ్ లార్డ్ సో ఇట్స్ కృష్ణ హూ లవ్ టు చూస్ యూ అండ్ ఇట్ ఇస్ నాట్ యూ హూ క్యాన్ చూస్ కృష్ణ సో యూ క్యాన్ కీప్ ఆన్ ట్రయింగ్ but you won't get released from this samsara it is he who will have to choose you and you must be blessed for to be chosen by him nayamaatma pravachaneena labhyah na medhaya na bahuna shrutena yame vesha vrunute te malabhyah whoever he selects he reveals himself to him so finally if I have to have his sakshatkara he reveals but whom does he reveal to whoever he chooses there was a full stop by vedanta Now, I came to know that he will have to choose. It's not that just by meditating I can reach him. He will have to choose. Then my next question was, how should I behave so that he chooses me? This should be the logical question now. Next was my question. Now that came the reply from Vedanta, Priyatama evahi varaniyo bhavati. Priyatama evahi varaniyo bhavati. One who is too much attached to him, one who cannot live without him, one who is longing for a spiritual union, is priyatama, his loved one. Varaniyo bhavati, he chooses his loved one. So priyatama evahi varaniyo bhavati. Now this all summarily led me towards that I must have devotion in my meditation. So that led to bhakti. Now let us graduate. First I had knowledge, not simple knowledge. Meditating knowledge, not simple meditation, with devotion meditation towards your Paramatma. So it's knowledge, meditation and devotion. Jnana, Dhyana, Upasana, Bhakti. So finally it should be Bhakti which leads you to Paramatma and not any other way. Because when Vedanta said, Jnana Tamevam Vidwan Amritaiha Bhavati, there were people who started arguing, just by knowledge you can reach Paramatma. It's not possible. It is not kevala jnana, absolute knowledge alone which will lead. It's bhakti rupapanna jnana, jnana clubbed with bhakti. Together only will lead you to Paramatma sakshatkara. So let's be clear on these three terms. It's jnana, it is upasana and it is bhakti. Both are different levels, one superior than the prior. So the lowest step is just jnana, the next step is upasana, the third step is bhakti. So one should have jnana, he must slowly graduate himself to upasana, where he is able to focus his mind, and he should graduate to a bhakta, where he adds devotion, where he loves, and he is always, he wants to be attached, to be in union with his Paramatma. So that is bhakti. And Krishna finally said, Arjuna, don't get confused that I started in jnana and ended with bhakti. I started in jnana, tamevam vidwan, amritaiha bhavati. But now I end in bhakti. Krishna says that, bhaktyatvananyaya shakyaha ahamevam ujo Arjuna. Bhakti is the only way. Bhaktyatu ananyaya shakyaha, ananyaha. Vedanta said, na anyapanthaha. Krishna says, ananyaya shakyaha. Both mean the same. There is no other way to reach me. But unfortunately, both use two different words now. Vedanta said, tamevam vidwan amritaiha bhavati, jnana is the only way. Krishna says, bhakti is the only way. Are both same or contradictory to each other? Both are same, but are different levels. That's the only difference. Jnana is second or third standard. Bhakti is 12th or MS. We have to keep it like that. Sneha purvam anudhyanam. Bhaktirityabhidiyate. Note again on a definition of bhakti. Sneha purvam anudhyanam bhaktirityabhidiyate. This bhakti is defined as follows. Dhyanam is bhakti. Now we got confused. Just now we thought after graduating from dhyanam, we are a bhakta. Whereas this Vedanta Vakya says that dhyanam is bhakti. It doesn't say absolute dhyanam is bhakti. Sneha purvam anudhyanam bhaktirityabhidiyate. That sneha, that affection and devotion is very, very important. So along with sneha, dhyanam leads you to bhakti. So bhakti, in other words, is sneha plus dhyana. Dhyana, in other words, is focus plus jnana. Is it clear now? Jnana added with focused mind without any obstacle is dhyana. Dhyana added with devotion is bhakti. So everything gets added, that's all. The core thing never changes. Still that jnanam remains. But once I add something to jnana, it becomes dhyana. I add something to dhyana, it becomes bhakti. So I have not changed the basic element now. That has remained the same. But I have added more elements to it. So finally bhakti is dhyana plus a focused mind plus devotion. All these three together forms bhakti. And that bhakti will lead you to him. Nayamatma pravachanena labhya na vedhaya na bahuna shrutena. Now you be devoted to him. You are the chosen Lord. Priyatama evahi varaniyo bhavati. Now Krishna discusses about that bhakti which will only lead to paramatma sakshatkara. We have one last question here. Before we start with the 7th chapter, Arjuna thought for a while. Krishna, you told me that karma yoga leads to jnana yoga and then to atma sakshatkara in 2nd chapter. Then you changed your own words and said karma yoga would directly lead to atma sakshatkara in 3rd and 4th chapter. Now I have a doubt left. The doubt is, maybe now you say it is bhakti yoga only which will lead to paramatma sakshatkara. Come next chapter, will you again say that karma yoga will directly lead to paramatma sakshatkara? This is the doubt of Arjuna now. Krishna said, na anyav panthaha ayanaya vidyate. Maybe I had an option there, Arjuna. Not here. Between karma yoga and jnana yoga, you can choose, but you don't have an alternate for bhakti yoga. This is the only way available. Devotion is the only means to reach your Lord, to reach his lotus feet. So don't ever think, in the next chapter, Krishna would start telling that karma yoga will directly lead to paramatma sakshatkara. It would never. It's only a way to lead you finally to bhakti yoga. Now, when will you be eligible to practice bhakti yoga? Naranam, Krishna, don't get worried about this verse. I'm just explaining you for academic interest. Just hear that, leave it. Because once you know the full meaning of this shloka, we will understand that we can never be a bhakta. That's the problem there. It says, Naranam, Kshina Papanam, Krishne Bhakti Prajayate, Krishne Bhakti Prajayate. Bhakti takes birth in Krishna, towards Krishna, in this Jivatma. When is it born? Naranam, Kshina Papanam. Once I clear all my papas, my bhakti takes birth. When do I clear all my papas? Janmantara Sahasreshu, Tapakarma Samadhibihi. Janmantara sahasreshu, at least in 1000 births, if I have performed my prescribed duty along with the required knowledge for that duty, I get cleared of my papas. Once my papas are cleared, then bhakti is born in me. And after bhakti is born, I do not know how many births I will have to take as a bhakta to reach the lotus feet of Krishna. This is a shastra vakya. So bahum janmana, many births, janmantara sahasreshu, tapaha, jnana, samadhibihi, naranam, kshinapapanam, krishne bhakti prajayate. So this verse is very important. Note this verse. We are going to have a reply by Krishna to this verse at the end of 18th chapter. Now this shloka is not in Gita. Now this is a shastra vakya. It says that you have to perform your karma yoga for many births. Get yourself cleared of all your dirt. Then you are eligible for bhakti yoga. Practice bhakti yoga for many births. You don't know which day you will get salvation. This is the shastra vakya. Now Arjuna was too much worried on hearing this dharma shastra vakya. So he questioned at the end of 18th chapter to Krishna. Krishna is going to give a reply. I'm not going to talk about that verse now. We reserve it for the last day of our discussion. So we will get to know how to counter this verse. It's Krishna who is going to give his own explanation. Don't worry about that, Arjuna. I know how to circumvent this condition of the Dharma Shastra. You must understand one. He is there always to help us by hook or crook. He will not allow us. But the only difference is, he can break the rule and help us, which he will never do. He will only circumvent for the sake of us. I gave an example yesterday. for Amavasya. Now, if Krishna wanted, he would have said, even if you start this battle on Amavasya, Duryodhana would lose. What is the problem? Krishna has the will to do it. He has got the power to do it. He will not do it. Because he has laid down the condition that a Josya can give an auspicious day. And if a Josya is honest, the day which he mentions will bear the fruit. So these are all the Dharma Shastram conditions laid down by him. He can flout the rule. He can say that, let it be on Amavasya, but still Arjuna would win. Nothing would go wrong. Arjuna would win. But he will never resort to that way. What he does is, he would circumvent again. He will make that day to be Amavasya, or make you not start the war on Amavasya. He would try and do all those, but not break the rule that if an auspicious day is given by a honest astrologer, it will be proved wrong. That he would never do. Because if he does that, for one Arjuna, he will have to reply to millions of people later on. So Krishna is not the one to flout, but to a surrenderer, he helps in some way or other. We must understand that. When I make the statement he is helping a surrenderer, don't think he is partial. That's not his job. He is impartial. But anyone, if someone comes to help, to seeking help from me, will I not help them? If he can do it, why not Sarveshwara? So he will definitely help his surrenderer. So again, it's Bhakti Yoga which will lead to my Paramatma, not others. At the beginning of 7th chapter, Krishna explain about this Bhakti Yoga, and who is the eligible candidate for Bhakti Yoga? Naranam Kshina Papanam Krishne Bhakti Prajayate. Thousands of birth. Clear your doubt. Then you are eligible to practice Bhakti Yoga. Whereas in the end of 18th chapter, Krishna gives a simple solution how to circumvent this shloka. So keep it in mind that Bhakti Yoga is not as simple as that. It is difficult because it's a consequence of Karma Yoga and Jnana Yoga. To know about Karma Yoga and Jnana Yoga, we have broken our heads for 6 chapters now. Something which is a result of Karma Jnana, how better and superior that must be. If the way itself is so hard, you see how it should be the destination, the result of Karma Jnana Yoga. So it's not easy to be a Bhakta. I'll give an example of Garuda Purana Shloka. Krishna there explains, who is my Bhakta? He says that my Bhakta should have 8 divine qualities. That's very important with him. And what should he do? He must, Mad Bhakta Jana Vatsalyam Pujayancha Anumodanam Madarthe Dambavarjanam Mad Bhakta Jana Vatsalyam Pujayancha Anumodanam Mad Bhakta Jana Vatsalyam. He should not find fault with any of my Bhakta. This is the first problem with all of us. We always find fault with people. So my Bhakta never finds fault. He is just ignorant. He turns a blind eye to the mistakes committed by my Bhakta. Mad Bhakta Jana Vatsalyam Pujayancha Anumodanam. If someone prostrates, if someone offers me something, he performs puja, you must be happy by looking at it. Mad Bhakta Jana Vatsalyam Pujayancha Anamodanam Swayam Abhyartanam Chaiva. It's not enough you agree or you permit others performing puja. You must do it for yourself too. Swayam Abhyartanam Chaiva. You must perform puja. Madarthe Dambavarjanam. Don't ever show haughtiness to me. That's one thing which Krishna can never agree on. We offer so many things to Krishna. We might do service for $1 million, for $1 billion. But whatever you give with your right hand must not be known to your left hand. There is a saying in Tamil, Valadukai Kodupadu Yedadukaikku Theriyakoodadu. You just keep giving. For the sake of giving, don't show off that I gave it to you. Now these are all single lights here. I have seen lights in many Divadeshams in temples down in Tamil Nadu. You will find a big name written there, donated by so-so-so-so-so. And that will have at least 26 characters. It's not less. And the effect of it would be, I can't see light, I can only see the letters written on them. I can see donated by so-and-so written in dark blue ink. There will be no light emitting from there, because it's already covered by the writings on that light. So he is interested in showing off that I have donated that light. Madarthe Dambavarjanam. Arjuna, please note that it is not, you are not giving to a layman. You are not giving to someone who doesn't have light. I created light. So please note the difference. You are giving for your benefit, not to my benefit. If you go and spend $1 million to Krishna, is he going to get added to any value? or you value adding Krishna, you cannot achieve anything. He is unaffected by all this. You are adding value to yourself by performing service to him. So madarthe dambavarjanam mat kathashravane preetihi. Whenever you hear stories about me, preetihi, be interested in hearing them. Mat kathashravane preetihi. Then he says that swara netranga vikriya. Whenever you hear about me, swara netranga vikriya, you must not be able to talk anymore. Your legs must start shivering. Tears must start rolling out of your eyes. He is my bhakta. Madarthe dambavarjanam, mad bhakta janavatsalyam, pujayancha anumodanam, swayam abhyartanam chaiva, madarthe dambavarjanam, mad kathashravane preetihi, swaranetranga vikriya. And lastly he said, one who never requests anything from me. That's a very important point of a bhakta. I go and stand before him for nothing. Then why do you go to have darshan at all? We all think we go to a temple to have darshan, to request something from him. Here is what I brought for you. What is that you have for me? This is called dehi me dadami me. Dehi te, I give this to you. Dadami me, you give to me. So it's not, it's just a give and take policy. So we all talk about give and take policy even with Paramatma. So I give you this, in turn, you give me this. No, don't go to do business with him. You must not request anything from your Bhagavan. Then why do I go there? Just for the sake and pleasure of having his darshan, go and stand before him. He has already done everything possible to you. What is that you have more to ask from him? He has given birth as a human being. He has given you intelligence. He has given you knowledge and the scriptures, the guiding scriptures to learn. And you have got a reasoning power. What not? What more you expect from him? He has given you all that is possible. All he has. Now it's you. You will have to thank him. It's left to you now to return, to reciprocate for all that he has given. So you go there to reciprocate, not to receive anything more. We go perform archana. And that pujari immediately asks, what's your gotra? What's your sutram? What is your gotra and charanam, bharadvaja gotra, apastamba sutra? Your star? Which is your star? Which is your month? All are asked by the pujari. Then I start telling, I am named Krishna. I am a yajushyakadhyayi. I belong to bharadvaja gotra. I am makhanakshatra. I am an apastamba sutra. All these are told. And immediately this pujari introduces me to Bhagavan. That would look like me every day morning, after getting up, going and standing before my father, prostrating before him, and started telling, you know who am I? I am Krishna. I am your son. You are my father. You only gave birth to me. And I belong to Yajurveda, Apastamba Sutra, Makhanakshatra. He is the one who named me Krishna. Now I am telling him I am Krishna. He is the one who gave birth to me. I keep telling him that this is my birthday. Is it all required? I need not get introduced to my father. And this father can fail. He may not remember. He may forget. But I have one father who never forgets anything. If my father is paralyzed, if my father is insane, he might forget my name. But this father is never paralyzed. He is never insane. So he will remember always. There is no need to introduce you when you perform an archana. Just go to hear the strings of divine names of your Lord. That must be the only purpose. For the sake of doing it, do it. For the sake of hearing your divine names, you hear to his divine names, not for any other purpose. Do you find any purpose? You go back to your home. Your child comes running. He wants you to keep him on his lap. You keep your child on his lap. You keep on talking to him. You make fun with him. The next neighbor, he came and asked, you have been with your son for half an hour now. What's the purpose? Can I enjoy? Can I give him an answer? I don't have an answer. Because I kept him on my lap. Not that thinking, after 32 years, he is going to pay my insurance and if I am back in India, he will take care of me. Is it that purpose I took him on my lap? It's just for the sake of having him. It's just for the sake of showing love and affection. I did it. If I am doing it with a son who just related to me for 30, 40 years in this materialistic world, can I not do it with a divine connection? Who is divinity and who is related in a more divine form than this materialistic form. So don't ever try to show damba, haughtiness to Bhagavan. Don't ever introduce yourself to him. If you go and want to do archana, let it be in the name of God. Why my name? Whenever your pujari asks, don't tell your name. Don't tell your gotra. It will be too foolish to introduce yourself to Bhagavan. He knows who you are and he knows better what you need than you. That's important now. What I know is much lesser. What he knows about me is much more. Take the case of a mother. She feeds the baby. The baby does not know how much to drink. The moment I give cereal, third month, 90 days, the baby has completed 90 days. Mother is trying to give cereal. It's used to only milk till date. So when I give the cereal, certainly the baby is going to push it off. It's not going to take. And what does his mother say? I know the stomach of the baby. I know how to feed the baby, not you. Does she agree when she pushes? Does she agree to the request of the baby? She will never. Why at 90 days? Even after 5-6 years, even after 10 years, if the boy denies to eat something, the immediate comment from the mother would be, please do what I tell you to do. I know better about your health than what you know. When this mother knows about that, will not that mother know about me? So he knows much better than this mother. Just leave it to him. Mother te dambavarjanam, mad bhakta jana vatsalyam, pujayancha anumodanam. So bhakta is the one who has just submitted himself to him. He will not request anything for himself. He requests, you know what does he request? He will request God himself to come to me. That will be his only request. He will go, you would have heard about Kamadhenu, Kalpaka Vriksha. You request anything from Kamadhenu, it will give you. You request, you ask for anything from Kalpaka Vriksha, it will give you. But you ask Kalpaka Vriksha to come to your backyard, will it come? It will never come, it will kill you. You ask Kamadhenu to come to your house, will it come? It will give you anything you want, but that won't come for itself. Whereas here is Krishna, you go to him, you ask for anything else, he would give you. You ask for himself, he will more happily give you. In fact, instead of asking him, you ask anything else, he is sad. I am willing to give myself to him. Why is that he is asking this 10,000 or 1 million or 2 million? I am waiting to give myself to him. Why is not he is asking me? So here is a Kalpaka Vriksha, a Kamadhenu, who is not willing to give anything else, who is willing to give himself to us. So go and ask him from him, not anything else. So Bhakta must have that thinking in his mind. Unless he has that, he is never termed as a bhakta. So don't think it's so easy to become a bhakta. You will have to develop your atma guna. You will have to progressively develop them. Now, to develop that, you need to know more about Bhagavan. The only way to develop bhakti within ourselves is, how do I develop attachment towards something? This is a watch. The more I know about this watch, the more I am desirous of getting this watch. The less I know about this watch, I don't desire. I am not interested in this watch. Now someone tells me, this watch, this microphone is beautiful and this costs more, and even if you are going to snooze, you sleep, you talk, you do whatever, it will be heard anywhere you want. The more someone keeps on adding value to this microphone and I get to know all those values. There is no point in adding value. I must be communicated about that value. So once I am communicated of all the glory, of all the greatness, values of this microphone, I am more attached towards this. So what Krishna does in the early parts of 7th chapter is, oh Arjuna, let me first communicate more about me to you. Only then you can develop bhakti in you. Unless I know that Krishna is so great, I will not have love towards him. I will not have affection towards him. So I must know more and more about him. And how does he reveal himself? Mai asaktamanaha partha. Yogam yunjan madashrayaha asamshayam samagrammam yatha jnasyasi tachrunu. Oh Arjuna, here, be patient, here now. Because it's now 6 chapters over. Even you would have seen it with any lecturer. If half an hour, we started say about 7:30, it is now 8:20 now, it's 40 minutes over. In 40 minutes, right from beginning, you were wanting to listen. You will be able to maintain your attention for half an hour, 40 minutes. And slowly it might deteriorate. Then this lecturer, if at all he is getting into an important topic, he will say, this is important for all of you to note now. Why does he say? Because he knows their attention is not here, he will have to divert that attention towards him now. If it's the beginning of the lecture, he won't make the statement. But half an hour, 45 minutes gone, he will have to make that statement. So here Krishna, 6 chapters are gone, Now he knows that Arjuna is going to look around somewhere. He is not going to hear to him. So he says, Tachrunu, O Arjuna, now you hear to me. You listen to me properly. Because I am getting you into a more important subject. Your subject of Atma Sakshatkara is over. Your Karma Yoga, Jnana Yoga is over. You can't ask any more questions to me now. Whatever I say now, please note it down. You don't have an option hereafter. I gave you all the options possible and independence possible till the end of 6th chapter. Close all your independence there. Now it's dependence on me. Now let me reveal myself, Arjuna. My asaktamanaha partha. One who has rested everything in me. He doesn't have anything. He has just left his intelligence to me. He has left his, rested his knowledge in me. He has rested his body in me. He has diverted everything towards me. My asaktamanaha partha. Yogam yunjanmadashrayaha. Yogam here refers to bhakti yoga. Yogam yunjan madashrayaha. One who wants to reach me starts practicing bhakti yoga. Asamshayam samagram. He knows that fully. Asamshayam, without any doubt. Any knowledge must have these two characters. You must have a foolproof, full, absolute knowledge. And second, that knowledge must be without any doubt. So clear all your doubts. Have absolute in-depth knowledge. Both these things are important about Bhakti Yoga. Tachrunu. I am going to teach you about that Bhakti Yoga. Arjuna, Tachrunu. Asamshayam samagrammam yathastasya nyasyasi tatu shrunu. Let me first explain about my greatness. In the 7th chapter, Krishna talks about his inherent natures, his qualities, his inseparable qualities. In the 9th chapter, he starts talking about his glories. Both are different. Just talking about my inherent quality is different from talking about my glory. If you want to know who Krishna is, I won't immediately start telling that he came from Mayapur, he came from India, all these things. Who Krishna is? Son of so-and-so, who studied so-and-so, who has come for so-and-so. These are the initial informations which I require from anyone. Prima facie information. Then once I know that, I add value to those informations. I add glory to him. These are all secondary informations. So the prima facie qualities of Krishna are mentioned in 7th chapter. The glories of Krishna are mentioned in 9th chapter. So this is the difference. So yathatmyam is 7th chapter. So mahatmyam is 9th chapter. Yathatmyam, mahatmyam. Two words are used by Swami Alavandar. So he says yathatmyam, his real inherent qualities. Mahatmyam, his glory and greatness. So Krishna explains all this for himself. Unfortunately, he did not get an acharya so that Arjuna could be preached now. Because Krishna assumes that position also to himself. Let me be the Gita Acharya. In all the 10 incarnations, only Krishna has got this name, Acharya, added to him. He is known as Gita Acharya. You don't say Ramacharya, Varaha Acharya, Narasimha Acharya. They are all added. It's Narasimha, Varaha, Matsya, Kurma. Whereas come to Krishna, he is known as Gita Acharya. The only reason is, he is the only person who gave us a Shastra. Who else teached us? Who else gave a Shastra? It's not Matsya Murthy, not Kurma Murthy, not Narasimha Murthy. But it was Krishna who preached us, which is useful even today. Now he says, Bhumirapo nalo vayuho. You must be devoted towards me, Arjuna, for the simple reason that I am everything for you and you are everything for me. We are that much related. Let me first reveal the relationship which you enjoy with me. Now Arjuna thought that Krishna is somewhere. Now he is sitting in my chariot. After 125 years, I won't find Krishna here. He will go back to his paramavatham, his moksham. I can't find him. Whereas Krishna says, you are mistaken, Arjuna. I am always with you. I am related in no less than 9 different relationships with you. It's not one relationship which I enjoy with you. I am related to you in many ways. Why related? I cannot be separated from you. And that's when Arjuna raised his eyebrows. He couldn't understand that Krishna is never separated from him. He asked, I don't find you holding me, Krishna. I am on my own. I am standing on my own. I am sitting on my own. How is that you say, I belong to you? How is that you say, you are my master? Thus Krishna explains, Bhumirapo nalo vayuhu, kammano buddhirevacha, ahankara itiyam me, bhinna prakriti rashtata, apareyam, itastvanyam, prakritim vidhime param, jiva bhutam mahabaho, yayedam dharyate jagat. I bear this entire universe, Arjuna, అహం కృత్స్నస్య జగతః ప్రభవ ప్రళయస్తదా కృత్స్నస్య జగతః. ఐ ఆమ్ ద ఓన్లీ క్రియేటర్, ఐ ఆమ్ ద ఓన్లీ వన్ హూ సస్టైన్స్, ఐ ఆమ్ ద ఓన్లీ డిస్ట్రాయర్. ఐ అగైన్ అబ్జార్బ్ దిస్ హోల్ యూనివర్స్ ఇన్ టు మీ, ఐ మేనిఫెస్ట్ ఇన్ టు దిస్ యూనివర్స్, ఐ సస్టైన్ దిస్ యూనివర్స్. ఐ ఆమ్ ద సృష్టికర్త, ఐఎమ్ ద లయకర్త, ఐఎమ్ ద రక్షక, ఐఎమ్ వన్ అండ్ ఆల్ ఫర్ దిస్ యూనివర్స్. భూమి రాపో నలో వాయు, హీ క్యాటగరైజెస్ ఆల్ దిస్ ఆబ్జెక్ట్స్ నౌ. భూమి ఆపహ అనలహ వాయు ఖం మనహ బుద్ధిరేవచ అహంకార అష్టవిధ. సో దెర్ ఆర్ 8 డిఫరెంట్ ఆబ్జెక్ట్స్ ఇన్ దిస్ అచిత్తత్వ. నౌ లెట్స్ రీక్యాపిచులేట్. అచిత్, చిత్, ఈశ్వర, దెర్ ఆర్ 3 తత్వంస్, బేసిక్ రియాలిటీ, బేసిక్ రియల్స్. అవుట్ ఆఫ్ దట్ అచిత్ ఇస్ ద నాన్ సెంటినల్ విచ్ డస్ నాట్ హ్యావ్ నాలెడ్జ్. చిత్ ఇస్ ద వన్ విచ్ పొసెసెస్ నాలెడ్జ్. దిస్ అచిత్ ఇస్ క్యాటగరైజ్డ్ ఇన్ టు 24 డిఫరెంట్ వెరైటీస్. సో దర్ ఆర్ టోటలీ 26 ఇన్ నంబర్. 24 వెరైటీస్ ఆఫ్ అచిత్, 24 కేటగిరీస్ ఆఫ్ అచిత్. 25th ఇస్ ద జీవాత్మ, 26th ఇస్ ద పరమాత్మ. సో నౌ కృష్ణ ఎక్స్ప్లెయిన్స్ ఆల్ దీస్ 24 కేటగిరీస్ అండ్ సేస్ దే ఆర్ ఇన్సెపరబుల్ ఫ్రమ్ మీ, ఐ ఆమ్ ఆల్వేస్ ఇన్ యూనియన్ విత్ దెమ్. అండ్ హౌ ఇస్ దట్ ఐఎమ్ ఇన్ యూనియన్? ఫర్ ఎగ్జాంపుల్ ఐ వేర్ దిస్ బ్రహ్మసూత్ర యజ్ఞోపవీత, దిస్ క్రాస్ బెల్ట్ ఆల్వేస్. నో ఏ బ్రాహ్మణ మస్ట్ హ్యావ్ దిస్. ఈవెన్ ఇఫ్ ఐ ఫర్గెట్ దిస్ ఫర్ వన్ డే, నో వన్ ఇస్ గోయింగ్ టు టెల్ మీ దట్ యు ఆర్ నాట్ అ బ్రాహ్మణ. బికాస్ ఎనీ వన్ హూ ఇస్ అ నోన్ బ్రాహ్మణ, వెదర్ ఈస్ గోయింగ్ టు వేర్ ఇట్ ఆర్ నాట్, హీఈస్ అ బ్రాహ్మణ. బట్ I must ensure that this doesn't fall off from my shoulders. Yes, I keep this. But it's not that this is inseparable from me. If I want, I can take it out and hang it in a nail, which many Brahmanas do. So that happens. If I want, I can get separated from this Yajnopavita. I can. Whereas, you take another case. You know about Karna with Kavacha Kundala? Karna was always born with, he was born with a Kavacha and Kundala. He had to cut it open to give it to the Indra. When Indra came in disguise, he has to cut open his kavacha and give it to him. So he thought he was inseparable from his kavacha, but finally he got separated. He is separated and gave it. Let me give you another example. This is a white piece of cloth. Now this whiteness adds value. So the guna, the attribute to this cloth is whiteness. This is a white cloth. Whiteness is the attribute, and this attribute is qualifying this cloth that this is a white cloth. Now someone asks me, is this whiteness and cloth one and the same? I will reply, of course not. Whiteness is different from the cloth. So cloth is different, whiteness is a color, cloth is a material. So this is a material, that's a color, both are not the same. Then that person requested to me, why can't you separate that whiteness and give it to me? I say, no, that's not possible, because it's inseparable. If it's inseparable, it does not mean both are one and the same. They are different. Just because they are different, it does not mean they can be separated. Do you agree to both these arguments now? Just because they are different, I can't say both are different only. I can't say that they can be separated, because this whiteness and cloth is different but can't be separated. And just because they are together, they can't be separated, they can't be one and the same. Whiteness is certainly different from the cloth. Now Krishna said that you are always inseparable with me. This chit and achit are inseparable with the Brahman. You are always in union with me. But that does not mean me and this chit are one and the same. This chit, jivatma, is different. Achit is different. But they are never separated from me. This is known as apritak siddha. In Vishishtadvaita Sampradaya, pritak siddha, separated. Apritak siddha, that which is not separated. So this chit and achit are always along with the Brahman, and that achit is divided into 24. Let me just explain to you how they get created. We are all too much inquisitive to know how am I getting created. One, I know the reason is my father and mother, but that's not the only reason, because they must be able to make something out of this. That is prithivi, appu, tejasu, vayu, akasham. I am made of all these five. But how were they created? Then I will explain, it is Prakriti. Then how was Prakriti created? We will keep on asking questions. How was that? How was that? How was that? Now there is a period which is known as Pralaya Kala. That's Pralaya Deluge. Absolutely nothing is existent. Only Brahman exists. ஏகோஹவை நாராயண ஆசீத் ந பிரம்மா நேஷானஹா நேமேத்யாவா பிருத்திவி ந நக்ஷத்ராணி நத்திங் எக்ஸிஸ்டட் இட் வாஸ் ஒன்லி த பரபிரம்மம் விச் எக்ஸிஸ்டட் டஸ் இட் மீன் தட் ஆல் ஆஃப் அஸ் வேர் பார்ன் அவுட் ஆஃப் நத்திங் தேர் ஆர் டூ டிஃபரண்ட் ஆர்குமெண்ட்ஸ் ஒன் இஸ் நோன் அஸ் அ சத்காரியவாதா அதர் இஸ் நோன் அஸ் அன் அசத்காரியவாதா அசத்காரியவாதா உட் சே எனிதிங் தட் இஸ் பார்ன் அவுட் ஆஃப் நத்திங் சத்காரியவாதா உட் சே எனிதிங் தட் இஸ் பார்ன் அவுட் ஆஃப் சம்திங் சோ ஒன்லி வாட்ஸ் லிவிங் ஒன்லி வாட் எக்ஸிஸ்ட் கேன் சேஞ்ச் டு அனதர் எக்ஸிஸ்டிங் ஆப்ஜெக்ட் இஸ் ஒன் வாதா தெர் இஸ் அனதர் வாதா எனிதிங் அண்ட் எவ்ரி திங் இஸ் பார்ன் அவுட் ஆஃப் ஜீரோ நத்திங் சோ நத்திங் வேர் ஆஸ் இட்ஸ் கிரியேட்டட் தட் இஸ் நோன் ஆஸ் அசத்காரியவாதா பட் சம்திங் எக்ஸிஸ்ட் அண்ட் தட் மேனிஃபெஸ்ட் டு சம்திங் எல்ஸ் இஸ் சத்காரியவாதா All these Vedantists, Advaitacharya, Vishishtadvaitacharya, Dvaitacharya, almost agree on Satkaryavada only. They never agree that something is born out of nothing. So that Asatkaryavada is ruled out. It's only Satkaryavada. Nothing cannot give birth to something. You must add something. Now any object for that matter, whenever it is created, you add something together, then a new thing is born. A new thing may be born along with some other things too. Say a byproduct, but still it is what exists turns to something existing. Nothing can be born out of zero, out of shunya. So shunya cannot give birth to anything. So something should exist, from that it should be born. Any theory goes by that only. Even creation of this world today, whichever theory you take, no one says that this universe, this earth is born out of nothing. They can't say. Even scientists agree it's born out of something. Maybe it dashed, there was a bang, there is this, that, whatever it is. But it's all formed out of something. So that something is known as Prakriti. That Prakriti is the most basic element of creation. Now that Prakriti is found along with the Brahman. You have to now assume Brahman. In that Brahman, you find two attached to him. Attached means, for the sake of convenience, I am showing them as though they are attached. It doesn't mean they can be detached. They can never be detached. They are always attached only. So this Achit, Chit, both are attached. Now during this Pralaya, this Chit and Achit remains attached with the Brahman. The difference between Srishti and Pralaya goes like this. In both the periods, Chit and Achit are always attached with the Brahman only. They are with the Brahman only. Whereas, what changes there? It's in sukshma form earlier, it is in sthula form now. There is a sukshma sthula difference. Define sukshma, define sthula. Sthula is nama rupa vibhaga arha. Sukshma is nama rupa vibhaga anarha. This is the difference now. Nama, I can name this as a watch now. I can call this as a circle now. So there is a name, there is a form. Where I can define a name and form, it is Srishti. Where I cannot define a name and form, it's Pralaya. So the same Jivatma exists, the same objects, all Achit exists, but it doesn't have a form or a name during Pralaya. It's again attached with the Brahman. With a name and form, it is attached with the Brahman during Srishti. So this is the difference between Srishti and Pralaya. It's always in attachment with him. It's never separated. Apratak Siddhi. But the difference is, I might not be called as Krishna. I may not have a body structure. Not only me, nothing on this earth or universe would have any structure, any form, any name. So, Nama Rupa Vibhaga Anarha is Pralaya. Nama Rupa Vibhaga Arha is Srishti. This is the difference between manifestation, which we call as creation, and destruction. So now, how does this all start? It's a beautiful process by Brahman. It's for many long years. Brahman is not interested in creation again. It keeps quiet because it has tried enough to get these people to his feet. It never happened. So why should I create at all hereafter? But you have one tattvam known as Kala Tattvam, time. That time and go, it goes and prompts him, oh Brahman, it's time now. Brahman has got two properties. One is known as Nitya Mandala, Sri Vaikuntha. The other is known as Leela Vibhuti, where we are all here. that Sri Vaikuntha is never destroyed during any pralayam. That's why it is known as Nitya Mandala. Whereas this Leela Vibhuti gets destroyed in every pralaya, every deluge, again gets created. So this repeated creation is Leela Vibhuti, whereas that is a Nitya Mandala. Vedanta Purushuktam says, Padosya Vishwabhutani Tripadasyamritan Divi Tripadurdha Udait Purushaha. Padosya Vishwabhutani. This entire universe which is recreated is 1/4. The mandalam which is never created or destroyed is 3/4. So Nitya Mandalam Sri Vaikuntham is thrice as big as our mandalam. When I refer to our mandalam, I am not talking from Tokyo to California. That's not what I refer to. Our mandalam is too big than what we can just assume, imagine. We can't imagine the size of our mandalam, of our earth itself. And more than earth, you got Bhuhu, Bhuvaha, Suvaha, Mahaha, Janaha, Tapaha, Satyam, 7 worlds above. Atala, Sutala, Vitala, Rasatala, Talatala, Patala, 7 worlds beneath. So you got 7 below and 7 above, and they total to 14 in number. Chaturdasha Bhuvanatmaka Mandam, Dashagunitottarancha Avarana Saptakam. They are totally 14 in number, and the total length, Panchashat Koti Vistirnai. Panchashat, they measure 500 crore yojana. This is the total distance. Let not get into what is yojana and how many miles, how many kilometers, how many foot. I don't know about all those things. It just says it's 500 crore yojana from Patala Loka to the tip of Brahma Satya Loka. That is the Vistirna, the length, breadth and depth of this loka. Now these lokas are all the created. Who created it? It was created by Brahma. And who prompted him to do so? In Nitya Mandalam, this Kala Tattvam will go and prompt him, enough. Can you start creation now? It's time. Because any day you will, they all have to come to you. If you stop creation, they'll be in this form, Nama Rupa Vibhaga Anarka. They don't have name, they don't have form. When they had names and forms, they did not practice Bhakti Yoga and reach you. Now they don't have name and form. Where is the question of practicing Bhakti Yoga? So at least for the sake of Bhakti Yoga, O Krishna, start creation. Unless you create, no one can practice. If no one practices, Shastra would go a waste. That is the important problem now. Now no one can see Shastra Veda to go waste. So there must be some receiver to the guidance of Shastra. There must be someone to act as per the directions of Shastra. If not, Shastra will go, no one will agree that it is a true source of knowledge. If they have to be a true source, then they must be proved right. So, O Krishna, go along, start creation. Then the Brahman immediately decides, it resolves. This is the only action which the Brahman does. It resolves, Bahusyam Prajayeya. This is an Upanishad Vakya. Bahusyam, let me manifest to many, many, many and many. Bahusyam, it never mentions any number. It never says that this is the form or this is the type. Nothing. Bahusyam Prajayeya. This is a Sankalpa. So how does the Brahman create? Just by its will. It never even moves its hands or legs. It will not. It remains in its place. So by its free will, it starts creating now. Bahusyam Prajayeya. Now on this resolution, what starts happening? I have seen in some cinemas, there will be some slow motion. Suddenly when someone enters, you will find all characters moving very fast. So that will happen now. When this Brahman decides Bahusyam, the moment it takes his will, everything starts running now because all were silent. There was a big lull during this pralaya. Now it has to start. And that Prakriti which was attached, Prakriti is Achittatva. That Achittatva did not have a form or a name. It was just a mass. It was along with the Brahman. And it formed part and parcel of Brahman. And that formed the body of Brahman. Now that started manifesting. And the first one to be created was known as Mahan. The first Tattvam is Mahan from Prakriti. So Prakriti manifested to Mahan. Mahan manifested Ahankara. So that was the third. First one was Prakriti. That changed to Mahan. That changed to Ahankara. Now Ahankara gets divided into three. It's known as Sattvika, Rajasa, Tamasa, Ahankara. Because this Prakriti is always in in union with sattva, rajas, tamas. That never fails. So you divide this ahankara into three. Sattvika, rajasa, tamas ahankara. From the sattvika ahankara, something is born. From the tamas ahankara, something is born. And pancha bhuta, pancha tanmatra. This tanmatra is an intermediary stage. Pancha bhuta is prithivi, appu, tejasu, vayu, akasam. I hope you are clear about that. And pancha tanmatra is an intermediary stage. I'll explain to you that. Now, you wanted to ferment milk to curd. I want to use the curd at 10 a.m. tomorrow. I just added some buttermilk today to the milk, kept it in my table, I slept. Suppose I open it tomorrow morning, it would be curd. I open it immediately, it would remain as milk. Whereas, I get up at 2 a.m. in the morning, open that vessel and see what it would look like. It won't be milk, it won't be curd too. It will be an intermediary form. It would have turned to be a milk, but it would not have reached the stage of a curd. That's an intermediary form. So this pancha, shabda, sparsha, rupa, rasa, gandha, these five are known as the intermediary tanmatra. So this five tanmatra and five bhuta, pancha bhuta are created from the tamasa ahankara. This tamasa ahankara gives birth to 10. From the sattvika ahankara, your five senses, organs of senses, your karma indriya and jnana indriya, all the 10 gets created from the sattvika ahankara along with the 11th manas. Manas also gets created from that. So now you got 11 indriyas, 10 indriyas and 1 manas. You got pancha bhuta and pancha tanmatra. What's the total now? Here it's 11, here it's 12, it is 10. So 11 plus 10, 21. Then ahankara 22, mahan 23, prakriti 24. That's why they take 12 to 24. So you have 24 achittattvams. Achittattvam are 24 in number. Alvar said, pongaimbulanum, puriyaindum, karumendriyam, aimbhutam. Ingivuyirei perahirithi, manangara manangale. All this add up to 24. Now Bhagavan has created this 24. Vedanta say, akashad vayuhu, vayor agnihi, agneer apaha, adhya prithivi, prithivya oshadaya. These all happen as a chain reaction. First one to be created was akasha. That's from the tamasa ahankara. Akasha, akashad vayuhu, from space, air, wind was born. Vayor agnihi, from wind, fire was born. Agneer apaha, from fire, water was born. Adhya prithivi, from water, lastly earth was born. So adhya prithivi, all manifested to the next stage. Now, we saw about these five intermediaries, shabda, sparsha, rupa, rasa, gandha. Shabda is sound. Sparsha is a touch feeling. Rupa is a form. Rasa is taste. Gandha is smell. Now, all these are the five characteristics of the five bhutas. Prithivi, appu, tejasu, vayu, akasham. You have to relate one of these to each one of them now. Gandhavati, prithivi. The character of earth is to smell. It smells. Then, the character of vayu, wind, is touch. Because you can only feel vayu. And the quality of fire is rupa. A form is visible in fire. The character of water is taste. You can only taste water. And the final quality of space is shabda. Whenever you go to a big place, you hear ho, a sound. So sound relates to akasha. Smell relates to earth. Rupa relates to agni. And so on and so forth. So shabda, sparsha, rupa, rasa, gandha. And they relate to prithivyaptejo, vayu, akasha. These five are the five characters of panchabhuta. All 10 created. Now after this, Bhagavan does a very, very important job. That's known as panchikarana. This panchikarana is so important because, now just now I explained to you, Mother Earth, its quality is, it has got fragrance, it smells. And when I look at akasha, it's sound, it's only sound, shabda. Whereas, whenever I look at the sky, I see blue, it's blue, so that's form. If I say blue, it relates to form. Form must be related only to fire, not to space. Then why am I seeing a form there? Form, blue is a form, blue is a color of a form, whereas I am seeing blue. When I look at water, which is sea, I must only taste. But whereas I see a blue water there, so what gets mixed up? There is some problem happening there. And what Bhagavan does is, he first keeps all these five bhutas, basic elements of creation, prithvi, apu, tejasu, vayu, akasham, on his table. Think that this is the creation table now. We will call it so. So this is the creation table of Bhagavan. He keeps prithvi, apu, tejasu, vayu, akasham. You know what he does? It's a very, very interesting action. Now he first divides this prithvi, earth, into two. He leaves 150% with prithvi. He divides the second half into four. And he adds up, he mixes up 12 and a half. 50 by 4 would be 12 and a half. So it's all 1/8 of the total prithvi. So 1/8, 1/8, 1/8, 1/8 is given and mixed along with the other four elements. So all other four elements get 1/8 the quality of earth. First job over. Second, up. He selects water, divides this into two, leaves the first half there, selects the second half, divides it into four, and 12 and a half. He mixes it with all other four. So finally, what do you get now? You get a mixture of all the five. Half of it remains there, and the balance half is divided into four and mixed into all other elements. This is known as panchikaranam. That's why when I see ocean, it's not only taste, I am able to see a form. When I see sky, it's not only noise or voice, I am able to see a color, because they all get mixed up. This is known as panchikaranam. Now this is the basic material to create a body. Because with fire alone you can do nothing. With space alone you can do nothing. With water alone you can do nothing. Now earth, rice, this paddy is grown out of earth. Take that paddy. You need fire to cook that. You need water to make it boil. You need fire, water. For that fire to burn, you need air. To keep the cooked rice somewhere, you need space. So you require all the five even to cook rice. You need fire, water, the rice paddy grown out of earth, air to make the fire burn, finally space to keep. So prithivyap tejo vayivakasha, all five are always required, whatever you do. If I am lecturing here, all the five are required. You are listening here, all the five are required. And all these five always are related to Shabda, Sparsha, Rupa, Rasa, Gandha. Now Bhagavan, with this clay, this ball of clay, he creates the first body. And this is all one side now. All the achits have got manifested to all this. Once he manifests this achit and the first body is created, you need an atma to permeate that body. Still, that's not decided by Paramatma. He looks at this other side of the body. All this jivatma are lying there in a zero state of jnana. That's the difference in atma now. In a sriti state, jnana differs. You got 10% jnana in someone, 0 in someone, 100 in someone, 80 in someone. Whereas there, it will totally be covered without jnana, with karma. Kindly note the difference there. I just said that there is no nama rupa. I never said the karma gets destroyed. It gets destroyed only during one pralaya. I will mention when is that. So karma is always along with the jivatma. Now Bhagavan takes account of all the karmas. Who has got the maximum punyam to become a Brahma? There was one soul who had lot of punyams accumulated to his account. Bhagavan selected, let you be the first Brahma, Chaturmukha Brahma. He had already a body made. Now, tadevanu pravishat, tadanu pravishya, satyatyaccha bhavat, niruktancha, niruktancha, nilayanancha, nilayanancha, vijnanancha, vijnanancha, satyancha, nruchancha, satyama bhavat. This is a Upanishad Vakya. Tadevanu pravishat. Bhagavan enters the jiva, he is already there. And inside, he is the driver in the seat of that jivatma now. He will have to drive the car. He drives the car into the body. So the first person, Brahma, is created. Created means nothing was created now. It all manifested. It all existed in a different form. It now exists in a different form. So, oh Arjuna, please believe that they all belong to me any day. Be it pralaya or srishti, they all belong to me. They are never separated from me. They remained with me earlier. They remain with me now too. They were with me during pralaya. They were with me during srishti. But the change is nama rupa anarka, nama rupa arha. This is the only difference. It was Brahman which was the cause. It's the same Brahman which is the effect. Cause and effect are one and the same. It is the same Brahman. But the qualification differs. How do I classify this Brahman? That was a sukshma chit achit vishishta Brahman. This was a stula chit achit vishishta Brahman. This is the only difference now. That was also a Brahman. This is also a Brahman. That universe is also Brahman. This is also Brahman. Pralayam is also Brahman. Srishti is also Brahman. But the difference is, during Pralaya, this Brahman had chit and achit without form and name along with it. During Srishti, the same Brahman as chit and achit with form and name. So it's again the same Brahman. Brahman would not change in its inherent character. The body manifests into chit and achit with the nama rupa vibhaga. So thus, the first atma, Brahma, was sent into this body. From then on, Brahman takes rest. By now, you must have noted the difference between Brahma and Brahman. I have alternated these two words wantedly now. Deliberately, I have been using this. Brahman is the ultimate almighty. Brahma is the first soul created, Chaturmukha Brahma. Brahma, Brahman. Brahman is the Napumsaka Linga as per Sanskrit. Brahman, Brihatvat, Brahmanatvacha, Brahmamityabhidiyate. Brihatvat, it's big, it's great. And just because it's great, it's known as Brahman. Brihatvat, it is big and great. Whereas Brahma is the one who is created, who is the person who had more punyas to his account. He had more punya, he became Brahma. And after this Brahma was created, Brahman takes rest. It says, now all along it was direct Srishti, which is known as Samashti Srishti. Whereas then on, it's going to be known as Vyashti Srishti, indirect Srishti. No more Brahman will come into play. It now presses Brahma into the job, and he has to take care of the Srishti henceforth. The Brahman will never have. It will go and rest in Kshirabdhi. That's his job now. I have done my job. I have created the basic elements. Made you understand how to create. Gave you all the four Vedas. Now it's your job to continue with the Srishti. So it's the same Brahman which manifested. Now tell me that if this gets manifested to this, what was there with the Brahman earlier? The same Brahman, its body of the Brahman which manifested. Always there are three karanas, there are three causes to any effect. It's known as upadana karana, sahakari karana, nimitta karana. Upadana, sahakari, nimitta. To a pot, mud is the upadana karana, the material with which it is made of, the material cause. To a pot, the pot maker, the person is the nimitta karana, one who creates, one who does, one who has the workmanship. Is a nimitta karana. Sahakari karana, all the machines and other equipments are sahakari karana, the helping ancillary cause. So one is an instrumental cause, the other is an auxiliary cause, the main is the material cause. To anything that is created in this world, there has to be three causes: upadana, nimitta, sahakari. To a pot, mud is upadana. To a pot, the pot maker is the nimitta. To a part, the machine and equipment is the sahakari. So you must have three. Now let's define those three causes for this universe. There has to be three. It's quite simple. Brahman is the pot maker. There is no doubt on that now. Brahman only created this universe. So let's term it as a pot maker or a goldsmith or a weaver, whichever you want. You are going to take the example of this cloth, take him as a weaver. You are going to take example of a mud pot, take him as a potter. You are going to take example of this chain, take him as a goldsmith. Because they are all the nimitta karana, that's clear. Now, where is the mud? Where is the gold? Where is the cotton to make this cloth? Unfortunately, to make this universe, I am unable to find a upadana karana, a material cause which can manifest into the whole thing in this universe. Because for a pot, mud can be upadana. Whereas, for a cloth, mud cannot be upadana. For a cloth, cotton can be upadana. But for a mud, cotton cannot be upadana. For a pot, so there are some upadana karanam for some effect. There can be some cause, and a related effect. Whereas here, if this universe has to be manifested, if this has to be created, I must find a material cause which can manifest to one and all objects in this universe. Is there a material cause like that? Can I find such a great material cause? Yes, you can. The Brahman itself. So it's the same Brahman which is the material cause too. So the Nimitta Karana, the pot maker, is also the material cause. I know you will all have a doubt here. I'll clear that doubt now. It's all very clearly explained, because now any mud, for example, this mud suddenly stood up, sat on this chair and started telling, I am going to make a pot. I am going to become a pot. Will a mud say so? It can never say so. Mud will remain a mud. The pot maker will only take a vow, I am going to make a pot. So the upadakana karana never has a free will. This material cause can never talk. It can never decide. It can never do anything. It's only the nimitta karana who can do. It's only the goldsmith, the pot maker who can do. So the person who can do is Brahman. No one needs to have any doubt there. Whereas upadana karana is also Brahman. How is that possible? It's possible because Brahman as such never changes. It remains the same. Whereas it's the body, part and parcel of this Brahman, which is Chit and Achit, they manifest. They only change. Like mud changes to a pot, the body of Brahman changes to this universe. I am just using, for easier understanding, the word change. Whereas it is just not changing. It is Prakriti becoming Prakrita. So the body of Brahman manifests into this various universe. It's a Brahman itself is the upadana karana. Bahusyam prajayeya. Because the Vedanta Vakya says, Brahman never resolves, let me create Brahman. But it resolves, let me be Brahman. Do you find the difference now? It never resolves, let me create this Jagat. It never says, let me create this universe. It says, let me manifest to be the universe. So Brahman itself is the material cause too. Brahman is the material cause as well as it is the Nimitta Karana. If I give an example to you, you will immediately be able to catch how this is possible. Now, I say that this body manifests, but Brahman remains the same. Now when this Brahman says, let me manifest as the universe, then can I not make a statement? This Jivatma and universe and Brahman are one and the same. Why can't I make the statement? You have been refusing all over this Advaita, talking about Vishishta Advaita, whereas here it looks as though, since Brahman itself manifests, since Brahman itself is the upadana karana, is the material cause which manifests this universe, why can't we call that universe and Brahman one and the same? Why can't we call that Atma and Brahman one and the same? Because the cause and effect are one and the same. We cannot. I'll give you an example. Take a peacock and it has got beautiful feathers. At times, the peacock starts dancing. At the sight of clouds, bearing water, rain-bearing clouds. At the sight of a female peacock, it spreads its feathers and starts to dance. So just it's similar to creation. This male peacock is Brahman. At the sight of the female peacock, Shreshi Mahalakshmi Tayar, at the sight of the female peacock, the feather of Brahman is this Jagat in the Sukshma form, in the macro form. So it earlier existed in a Sukshma without Nama, without form, as a folded bunch of feather with the peacock. At the sight of this Sri Mahalakshmi Tayar, now this peacock is going to dance. And what does it do? It spreads the feather. Now this spreading is Srishti. The whole thing gets manifested now. The form and names are known. Once Srishti is over, it can again fold back its feather. Srishti is over and Pralayam comes again. So this is an example. Now this, in this example, let me cite this. Now this feather, does it form a part of the peacock or not? It is. Yes. So this manifested universe, does it form a part of Brahman or not? It does. It can never be separated. At the same time, just because it forms a part, can I call peacock and feather are one and the same? I cannot. I will immediately reply, the peacock is different from the feather. So, this universe has to be different from the peacock. Peacock is different and feather is different. This universe is different from the Brahman. Whereas, it is the feather of the peacock which gets spread. Again, it goes into itself. Now, can I say, just because this feather it is getting spread, peacock is getting affected? It will never get affected. It's as happy as ever before. So this Brahman, just because it manifests its body, is never affected. Because if you say that something is a upadana karana, you invite trouble there. The trouble is, if this mud changes to a pot, I have to agree change to mud. Whereas, no Vedanta will agree any change to Brahman. That's the issue. Nitya avikaraya shuddhaya, nityaya paramatmane, sadaika rupa rupaya vishnave sarvajishnave. This Brahman never changes in its qualities, never changes anything. Whereas, if an upadana karana is agreed, it has to change. Only then it can become. Whereas here, take this case. This feather got spread. This feather got folded. Was there any change in the peacock? There was no change. Peacock was as good as ever before. Whereas, the change occurred only in the feather. Take the peacock as Brahman. Take the feather as the sukshma chetana chetana, folded feather. Take the spread feather as the sthula chetana chetana. And at the sight of rain-bearing cloud, or at the sight of Mahalakshmi Tayar, this Brahman manifests. Once the manifestation is over, it feels it's enough, it again shrinks, it again folds back its feather. This is one example. Take another example of an ocean. You find so many waves coming out of the ocean. Tannule teraitthedun tarangavan tadankadal, tannule teraitthedun tadanguhinna tanmabol. This is Thirumalisiyazhvar's song from his famous Prabandham. Tannule teraitthedun tadangavan tadankadal, tannule teraitthedun tadanguhinra tanmabol. Tannule, you find an ocean. And from that ocean, you see waves going up and going down. Now, are these waves out of the ocean? Certainly yes. Because these waves went up and they came down, was the ocean affected? Never. Just because the waves came out of the ocean, are these waves different or same as ocean? Can I say ocean equal to waves? I can't. Certainly waves are different from the ocean. But at the same time, ocean, the waves form part and parcel of the ocean. Now, just because these waves came up and they came down, ocean was never affected. So, Brahman will never get affected because his body manifests. That remains the same. So, the second example is of an ocean. The first example is of a peacock. Second is of an ocean. Third is a worm. I exactly don't know the name in English of that worm. It can leave a string out of his mouth and build a small house with his string. Say a spider, whatever it's okay. It's a spider. So a spider, it gives out thread from its mouth. It vomits thread. Now, it vomits the thread. A thread comes out. Suppose it feels, it sights an enemy. You know what it would do? It used to keep hanging from the last thread. It will start pulling in the string to its own mouth and finish the whole house. You won't find that house in the fifth minute. So this string came out of the spider? Yes. If just because it came out of the spider, was the spider affected? No. Because it came out of the spider, can I call the thread and spider one and the same? I can't. So Brahman and universe have to be different. They're not one and the same. Because this Brahman manifests to be universe, don't think that the Brahman would be affected. So this is a manifestation which happens. It takes back again. Tannule teraitthedun taranguhinna. Think, always remember the example of a spider and the thread given by the spider. The example of an ocean and the waves that come out of the ocean. Example of a peacock and the feather which it spreads and dances of a peacock. Once you remember these things, you know how Brahman creates. Brahman is unaffected, and the chit and achit which are always in union with Brahman, they are the one that changes. Now that change, once it changes, has a name and form, that is Srishti. Once it's over, does not have a name and form, that is Pralayam. This Pralayam is of four types. Prakrita Nitya Pralaya, Naimittika Pralaya, Atyantika Pralaya, Prakrita Pralaya. Nitya Pralaya, every day someone dies, someone is born. So that is Nitya Pralaya. Daily I die, daily I am born. Nitya Pralaya, not to worry too much. Next is Naimittika Pralaya. Naimittika is, at the end of the day time for Brahma, three worlds would be destroyed. Bhuhu, Bhuvaha, Suvaha. So that's known as Naimittika Pralaya. It's caused by the end of the day of Brahma. Naimittika Pralaya. Nothing else gets affected by that. It's only these three worlds. And Brahma never interferes. Because Brahma is still sitting in the seventh world. So he has got all capacity to recreate this. He takes care. Brahma will not enter, interfere. And next is the Prakrita Pralaya. Prakrita Pralaya is at the end of Brahma himself. It's not at the end of the day of Brahma. It's at the end of Brahma himself. You know what happens? Again it's a beauty. Now, when it was created, Akashad Vayuhu, Vayor Agnihi, Agne Rapaha, Adhya Prithivi. The last one was Prithivi, earth. Now this earth, it goes back and settles. It's known as Laya. Since now it was earlier known as Srishti. Now it's all known as absorption. It is Laya. Now the last earth gets absorbed into water. Water into fire. Fire into wind. Wind into Akasha. And all these Panchabhuta, Panchatanmatra into Tamas Ahankara. Ahankara into Mahan. Mahan into Prakriti. Prakriti into Avyakta. Avyakta into Tamas. Tamas into Brahma. So they are all absorbed again. So one way they all get created. The other way they all get absorbed. Vedanta say, Yato vayumani bhutani jayante, yena jatani jivanti, yat prayanta bhisam visanti, tad vijignyasasva, tad brahmeti. No, that's Brahmam. Which is Brahmam? Which is so big, which we have been trying to explain for 2 hours now. So Brahmam is so big, Arjuna, and everything belongs to me. I am never separated from you. Be you be in pralaya form or during the period of srishti, you are with me, you are my belonging, you are my property. If you understand that, you will have no problem in getting bhakti and devotion towards me. Just because you don't know who you are and who I am, think that I am so big and what are you? We keep on talking I, my. This is known as I-ness and minus. Ahankara and Mamakara. We only talk about this Ahankara, Mamakara, whereas where we are, what's our ratio or proportion in this universe now? It's getting created just by the wink of an eye of this Brahmam. It's getting destroyed by the sankalpam of Brahmam. Where am I in this whole drama? So let's just know, we have only one solace, which is bhakti, which is Krishna bhakti. So now Arjuna has to understand. Krishna says, Bhumi Rapo Nalo Vayuhu, Kammano Buddhi Revacha, Ahankara Itiyamme, Bhinna Prakriti Rashtada, Apareyam, Itastvanyam, Prakritim Vidhime Param. All these 24 belong to me. The 25th Jivatma also belongs to me, and I am the controller. And he is related in three most important ways. One, he is a Sheshi, we are a Shesha. He is a Dharaka, we are a Dharya. He is a Niyanta, we are Niyamya. Niyanta is a director, is a controller. We are the Niyamya, controlled. He is a Dharaka, one who holds us. We are Dharya, one who is held. He is a Sheshi, the master. We are a Shesha, the servant. Is it not very clear now? Now Arjuna, since I am related in more than one way to you, you will have to perform this bhakti yoga. And that's the only way to reach me. I have left one last pralaya, Atyantika pralaya. Now the pralaya, nitya, naimittika, prakrita, atyantika pralaya is for an individual jivatma when he gets released from this materialistic world and reaches Shivaikuntham, never returns. That's known as atyantika pralaya. Now that pralaya is only for an individual. It never affects others. And nitya pralaya is also for an individual. It will not affect the next person. Whereas prakrita pralaya, naimittika pralaya or together. Prakrita pralaya is for everyone. Naimittika pralaya is for three worlds. So everything gets destroyed. Whereas here, don't think that in prakrita pralaya, we will all be surrounded by water. It's a foolish thought. Because I have already told you, all these five are going to get back to him. It is akashat vayuhu vayor agnihi. Earth into water, water into fire, fire into wind and wind into space. Nothing is there. You won't find any water around you. All this water, fatter, businesses, all is only in Naimittika Pralaya, when the three worlds gets destroyed. But in last Pralaya, which is Prakrita Pralaya, nothing is applicable. You won't find anything except Brahmam. And where do you find the Brahmam? He is there, he is all pervasive. He permeates into everything. You will find Brahman, Brahman and Brahman only. And all this, in a small form, they are attached to them. Without a form, without name. So, Bhumi Rapo Nalo Vayuhu Kammano Buddhirevacha Ahankara Itiyamme Vinna Prakriti Rashtatha Apareyam Itaspanya Prakritim Vidhime Param. Now, just Arjuna was awestruck. He couldn't believe. What is this of Krishna? What's he trying to explain to you now? Once I understand this, a person who has understood all this, Krishna, what do you think of him? And that person is my Bhakta Arjuna. Let me explain the qualities of my Bhakta. Thus Krishna starts there. Eta dyonini bhutani sarvani tyupadharaya mattah parataran nanyat kinchidasti dhananjaya. Oh dhananjaya, you can't find anyone greater than me. I am the greatest. I find no parallel and I am unequaled. I am the Parabrahma. Mayi sarvamidam purvatam sutre manigana iva. And everything is attached to me like a string, like a lot of beads, money. You take the case of bells. There are small bells which are attached to a string. You take a string and you try to put many bells into it. You find the string inside and Krishna says, I am that string, I am that thread. All these are the monies, the bells. They are all attached to me. Sutre manigana iva. Why does Krishna give this parallel? It's so important to note. You can just draw three important concepts from this. Whenever, say for example, 100 beads are attached to a thread and you won't find the thread inside, you can only see the bells outside. Thread is not visible. Thread is only one, but the bells are too many in number. Lastly, you wrongly believe that since the bells are too many in number and the thread is so flimsy, the bells are holding the thread. This is what you think. So these three are the concept there. Now Arjuna, all are wrong. All these bells are attached to one thread. Thread is one. These are all many. Similarly, all these are many. Chit, achit, and with all their forms and names, I am only one. They are all attached to me. Like many bells to one thread. Nityo nityanam, chetanas chetananam, yeko bahunam, yo vidadadi kaman. This is an Upanishad Vakya. Nityo nityanam, the eternal, to this all eternal jivatma. Chetanas chetananam, the most knowledgeable, to the knowledgeable jivatma. Chetanas chetananam, yeko bahunam, the only Brahman, to all this atma, vidadadi kaman. Just completes whatever they desire. He fulfills the desires of this jivatma. So nitya nityanam, chetanas chetananam, yeko bahunam, yo vidadadi kaman. It all talks about the singularity of the Brahman and plurality of the jivatma. And that's proved by many bells to one thread. And the second concept is, you can only see the thread. You can only see the bell, not the thread. So you can only see all this manifested universe, not the embodied Brahman. The Brahman is not visible, but that doesn't mean the thread does not exist. It's very much inside. When you will know that the thread exists, the moment you pull out the thread, you will know who was bearing whom. Till that moment you would think that the bells are all visible, bells are holding the thread. Oh Arjuna, remove the thread for a moment, then see the plight of all these bells. You won't find them there. They will all fall like a pack of cards. So I am Brahman and everything is attached to me. The moment I detach, which I cannot, I will not. I am always attached. So the moment I detach, nothing can be held. So you are all the held. I am the holder. You are all attached to me. Sutre manigana iva. So here, mai sarvamidam prodham, sutre manigana iva. Once someone understands, realizes all this, Arjuna, Chaturvidha bhajante mam janas sukritin arjuna artho jignyasur arthaarthi jnani cha bharatarishabha tesham jnani nitya yuktaha eka bhaktihi vishishyate priyoki jnaninaha atyarthamaham sachamama priyaha udara sarvayevaite jnani tvatmaiva mematam askritasahi yuktatma maveva anuttamam gatim bahunam janmanamante jnanavamman prapadyate vasudeva sarvamitisa mahatma sudurlabha. That is when Krishna was really drawn into his bhakta. He forgot Arjuna. He forgot the battlefield. He forgot everything. And he only remembered about Bhakta. Let us remember about Krishna Bhakta at tomorrow evening, 7 PM here. So I know I have taken some extra time today. Instead of going ahead with the 7th chapter, I have spent some time on this because it's more important to develop bhakti. Unless you understand this big, is your master. So great is your creator. How will you get absorbed in him? How will you get drawn towards him? That's the reason why we have spent time. Even if you get to know only one verse, let it be clear. There's no point in rushing through 700 verses. Even if it's one verse, let's understand the total meaning of that verse. Krishna already said, absolute meaning without doubt is very, very important. Any knowledge must be absolute. You must not be left with any doubt in your minds. If you go out with one doubt, it will manifest to 100, like this universe getting manifested. Don't do that. If you don't have any doubt, that 12 will become 10 when you reach home. If you have 10, you will certainly have 100 by the time you reach home. So let's be clear. This is the greatness of your Brahman, greatness of your master, and this is how you have all been created. We have been created. Should we not thank our creator? Should we not reciprocate all that he has done to us? The only reciprocation he expects from us is not money, is nothing else other than bhakti. So that bhakti, the devotion, unconditional devotion and surrender is what Krishna expects of all of us. I am sure you would do it, including me. We should try. It's only trial. No one can say absolutely. We all keep trying. The moment he decides that here is when I am going to choose this Atma, we have it. But keep your eyes open. Keep your ears open. Wait for the day when he will choose you. Till that day, our job is to do our duty, and that is bhakti yoga. Let's again dwell on a bhakta, the qualities of a bhakta, the greatness of a bhakta at tomorrow evening, 7 p.m. Thank you all. We have made some announcements already. Kindly donate your mite. Whatever is possible by you, all are going towards Krishna Kaikeryam only. So let me request you again. This is my humble request. We kindly donate whatever is possible by you. Also fill up the forms which are given to you. Now, we are not on a fundraising tour. We are only on a Gita tour and a Bhagavata tour and a Ramayana tour. But still, since I have come all the way, I thought that we could help some Divyadeshams, and I have already explained to you what are all the jobs we are doing back in India. So kindly be, this is my humble request to you, kindly be large-hearted whenever you donate. Thank you all.